a bibliography. This is not a list of approved books. These are books that have been written in the area of spiritual warfare or books that would help you. We have people that are here that are ministering to Indians. Had the opportunity of ministering to Indians in Canada and also to Apaches on the reservation. And you need to understand something of their animistic beliefs and backgrounds if you really want to help them. These people live in a lot of fear. And so there are books in here on different Indian tribes, Indian groups in America that are written by non-Christians that are in the list, but are very helpful books because they deal with the whole background of where these people are coming from. So we want you to know that. I want to mention some books that some asked me to mention, and then books that you cannot get out here. If you're going to get these books, you're going to have to send away for them. They're special books, and they're of significance. Number one, Ensign and Howe asked me to recommend his book. He comes to our conference. He's sick. This book is on a power encounter techniques. So if you're interested in power counting, it's called Counseling the Demonized by Ensign, and he was not able to come. Also, the Christian Publisher Association, they've asked, and in fact, possibly the pastor wrote the introduction to the Birch's book. The Birch's book, this book, is also on power encounter, techniques of power encounter. There are missionaries for many years in the Orient. What is interesting, there's a chapter in here, how to test the spirits, or how to test the spirit behind the spirit. So you may find this book very helpful for that chapter alone. Just some oldies are Macmillan's, The Authority of the Believer and The Encounter of Darkness. If you don't have those, I would encourage you to get those and add them to your library. We have a brand new book that just came out. I got it Monday or Tuesday and wasn't able to read it. There's possibly one copy of this book left. If you are a pastor or a theologian, this book is a must for you. Ed Murphy, when in his book, he's over here, Ed Murphy talked about Clinton Arnold, who is a professor at Talbot Seminary, who wrote this book on Ephesians, Power and Magic. It's one of the most awesome books written, but it has an awesome price. It's printed in England. It's $32 for 170 pages. But let me tell you, it's 170 pages of dynamite. It's the best book I've ever read on Ephesians. There's only one copy left out there. But he's written a new book. Please be seated. He's written a new book that just came out, which is The Powers of Darkness. And it's the principalities and powers in Pauline's letters. No one has done a book like this. Gone through the Pauline epistles that's come out yet, where he deals with Paul's dealing with principalities and powers. Because this has been a real issue. You know, is it only a gospel issue? You know, and after the Gospels, there's no dealing with the enemy and so on. This is written on a scholarly level. This is a very brilliant man. I know Dr. Neil knows him very well. And Clinton Arnold's book, it'd be a worthwhile book getting. I would like to recommend for general warfare, if you're not getting Bill Gothard's bulletin, this is the newest one. I haven't had a chance to read it. It just came. This has the best material that I have read in here on iniquity, the iniquity of a father, how to deal with pages and pages of tremendous material, how to deal with the iniquity of the fathers that pass on to children. And we're going to get into children, but of the four, it's $15 for the four volumes of this magazine. I worked with him on the second volume, which was on dealing with those who are demonized. I think it was volume two, it's one with the squirrels on the front. And that is just loaded with warfare. This one is about half warfare. And so it's just very well done material. It's called Life Purpose Journals, The Power of God in Us. And there are four of them in the series, and it's $15 for the four. And you can get it from them in Oak Brook. Here are some books that you cannot get in a bookstore. If you're working with animist people, or if you're going to go to Africa, you want to get the world of spirit. It's in your book. It's written by Scott Moreau, and Scott is teaching now at Wheaton College Grad School, and he teaches there in the missions department. And this book is a textbook in Kenya, Africa. It is excellent book on the African and his background. I highly recommend this book if you're working with anyone in animistic backgrounds. Also, they have on the table there the Filipino Spirit World. If you don't know anything about animists, and they're all over America, aren't they? And they're living in their communities, and they're practicing animistic practices here. If you don't understand animists, get the Filipino Spirit World. You can get it right out there. That gives you an understanding. The same spirits that stock the Philippines, I gave it to a fellow who's doing a counseling internship under me, and this fellow read it. He was from the Caribbean, and the same spirits that walk through the Philippines walk in the Caribbean. I just got back from Maui, Hawaii 2 weeks ago, and the people over there who are being terrorized by spirits are being terrorized by the same spirits that walk the Philippines. The lady in white with the cloven hoofs and all of this. The same, it's that book will just put you into where these people are that are living in fear of spirits. An excellent book. It's a together book, a companion book, and the name of the book is Tearing Down Strongholds with a companion guide called Worship and Warfare. This is excellent. It was written by a missionary for 30 years with team in the Philippines, in Taiwan. In Taiwan, there are more altars and shrines per people than anywhere else in the world. This is just an excellent, excellent book. Yes, sir. Weber. Okay, but to get this book, the place you get it is Missions Frontier in California. It's the only place I know where you can get this book. So if you want this, you need to write them. They have an 800 number, but it's like $7 or something. It's reasonable for the two of them. The companion book, Worship and Warfare and Tearing Down Strongholds. The telephone number is 1-800-647-7466. Just an excellent, you'll be thrilled with this. And then the last book that is a World Vision publication you must get from World Vision, that has a lot of interesting articles in it, is Facing the Powers. And so this book is not a book that you find in bookstores. It's a book you get from World Vision. It's also in California by Mark publication aspects. So I wanted to run through, and then there's one more. That's offered here, and we said it's the only one. This is probably the most complete anthology on Satanism that you can get, and it's available here. You can't get it in bookstores, but it is available here. And if you're dealing with a Satanist or you want resources, you got some kids in D&D who deals with D&D, who are resources for these people, where you can get more information or whatever, is in this book. It's just a worthwhile getting book. Also, a little bit later as we get to children, we're going to share with you what they are offer. We'll give you free. And then an oldie but goodie, if you haven't had this for devotions, Get Born for Battle by Arthur Matthews, the fellow who was the last missionary out of China. And this is just writings of his whole life, an excellent book, Born for Battle, 31 studies on spiritual warfare. It'll just warm your heart. Just read a chapter a day, keeps the devil away. It's just an excellent little book. We hope. When I do a conference, let's see if I can find my notes here. I got stuff all over the place. When I do a conference, I usually start off, some of you have heard me, I usually start off with a statement. It's made by one of our authors here. People may not live what they profess, but they will always live what they believe. Don't ask a man, if you want to find out what a person really believes, don't ask him. But watch him in a crisis. And his response will reveal to you what he believes about God and God's power. That is an awesome, awesome statement, isn't it? We make a lot of professions, but when push comes to shove, do we really stand? And do we really believe? The man who made that statement is Dr. Tim Warner, who's going to come here for a moment and just share his book that's out in print, and what is unique about his book, and why possibly you may find it helpful in your library. Dr. Tim.
First of all, that statement is a quotation from my major professor at college, Dr. Milo Rettiger, and I don't know where he took it from, but these are the kinds of things that get passed on because I think they're true. My book came out of an invitation to do a lecture series at Fuller Seminary a few years ago, and so I had to put some of my thoughts in writing, particularly on the subject of power encounter in world evangelization. And as I then began to edit those lectures and adapt them somewhat to this country, it comes out as a sort of composite of spiritual warfare on an international basis. But I suppose its strengths is that it has the cross-cultural perspective, but that gives it an objective look at our own culture as well, so that we're not looking at it with the often myopic view that comes from a lack of an international perspective. So I suppose those are the strengths that I would see in the book. Someone else probably needs to speak to that better than I.
That is the strength of his book. If you know any missionaries, I would buy them Tim Warner's book as a gift. I was vice president of one of the largest missions in the world for 7 years before I got involved in the counseling center here. I travel with many different missions, doing seminars all over, and the missions that are missionaries who are washing out because they don't understand the enemy and what he's doing. It's a tragedy. And this book is an excellent book for missionaries. It's written on it's easily readable, but it has tremendous information for those that are dealing with other cultures. I would like Mark Bubeck to come and to share with us. Mark has written The Adversary and Overcoming the Adversary, which have been out for years and years, probably the two best-selling books in warfare. But Mark has written a new book, The Revival of Satanism. And I want Mark to come and to share why God laid this on his heart and why this particular book may be a real benefit to you.
I think many of you know that I was led into the study of spiritual warfare through an encounter with the Lord when I was praying about something that's been a very important subject to me since my very early years of ministry, which is revival, spiritual revival, which our country desperately needs and our world needs. And as I was pastoring toward the end of my pastoral ministry, the Lord just constrained me to write this book almost as urgently as he constrained me to write The Adversary many years ago. And I believe that it is a practical handbook for helping people to get a hold of what you can do about praying for revival. In it are those little prayers, which are, I thought I had a copy with me, but, oh, you have it in your, the prayer patterns for revival. And it gives a systematic way, using Nehemiah's intercessions and experiences in leading Jerusalem to revival and the kind of praying that that takes. So I hope it'll be something that Lord really uses in our culture to help spur us toward what I believe is coming. I believe God's going to breathe on us a great awakening of his grace. And may it be soon.
So if you've read Mark's book, you see it's really a book on prayer revival, calling the church to pray. We have some extra material that you may look at, and if you want to copy it, you can, that we have here. One is The Battle for the Mind. These are handouts. These are studies for someone who is struggling with problems with the mind. Another one that we've done is Biblical Protection in Prayer. And this is new things, a lot of brand new stuff that we just typed up or just received from somewhere. We get stuff from all over. But you may want to look at that. This one is just awesome. Ed Sivoso, who Dr. Ed Murphy knows very well. Ed Sivoso, I believe, is the brother-in-law of Luis Palau. Ed Sivoso has designed a plan, and Dr. Murphy's going to share it when he speaks, on how to take our cities for God. It was so taken by Bill Gothard that he had Ed Sivoso go to his headquarters, make videos, and so for the pastor seminars this year, this video of Ed Sivoso sharing this plan, how people could take their cities for God with a warfare stance. It's just tremendous. And It's here. If you want to see the actual, we have it here, and if you'd like to look at it, it'll be on a table out there. Another thing is aftercare. What do you do after someone has come to freedom? You might find some material there. I grabbed everything that we had on animism in here. What do you destroy? What do you look for in a home? What should an animist get rid of? What shouldn't they get rid of? Some of that type of material is in here, and you may find that very helpful dealing with people from an animistic background. And then if you want to have a deliverance team, here is a questionnaire kind of thing that you may want to share with people. The next thing was really interesting. The other day, or a couple of weeks ago, I was sitting in the office and I thought, you know, I've read the Bible through so many times, marking everything with demons in it. Have you done that? You know, all the New Testament, all the Old Testament, doing Greek word studies, and I'm getting different computer programs that do half the studying for me. I just push buttons and out it comes. And I've been working on all of that, and I turned to Mark one day, and I said, Mark, you know, I know what demons do. I'm sure that there's not a demon passage in the Bible, except my wife found one I didn't mark. Can't believe it, about the goat gods, which was, I can't remember where it was, but anyway, she said, did you see that? And I said, I'm sure I did, but I didn't mark it, so I got the goat gods, I got that marked. But I said, I don't know what angels do. You know, in Hebrews where it says angels minister to the believers. So I went down to my good theological library and picked out all my books on Hebrews, and I looked, and you know what the authors told me? That angels minister to believers. And I thought, well, I wonder what they do. You know, they didn't have to write a book to tell me that. I already read it. But you know, I went to an old standby, and I think of when you think of Dr. Fred Dickinson, you think of his second book, but you may really have missed something by not, you want to get my picture down here? It's better that way. Angels, Elect, and Evil. And he has a tremendous chapter in here of how angels minister to believers. Fred, you want to come and just share these two books and how God is using these books?
Well, I hope he's using them well. The textbook is a crossover book that it means it's a textbook and popular reading. Angels, Elect, and Evil was published in 1975 by Moody Press. And the first half of it deals with good angels, ones who did not fall, second half with evil. It's right down the middle, see? And it should have been two-thirds good and one-third evil, right? That's an in-house joke. Yeah? But we deal with their nature, their creation, their activities, relationship to God, to believers, interangelic activity, rank, and number, and basically then the second section deals with Satan and demons, and that was my first publication on that. The second book, Demon Possession and the Christian, was born out of a concern for God's truth and God's people after having counseled for, at that time, I think about 15, 16 years with people who had been in oppression. And I was concerned because so many people were hurt by those who say Christians can't be inhabited by wicked spirits. And if you are inhabited by wicked spirits, you're not a Christian. What a put down. Instead of looking at the facts as they are, presuppositionalists, those who already have their mind made up, tell us what we can and we cannot observe. And my position is theology, chairman of theology at Moody Bible Institute, and our middle name is Bible, and I'm chairman of theology, and I thoroughly believe the Bible is the only final answer for doctrine and for life. But I think sometimes the Bible doesn't give us all the answers that we'd like to have. You know, by the way, it says very little about heaven, but we're going to spend a long time there. We know the basics. But I think what I've tried to do here is show how the Bible helps us along this line. The first part of the book deals with some basic questions. What are demons? What's demon possession? What is a Christian? By the way, that's a section you might want to look at. What is a Christian? I think that could be very helpful. It's a section on that you could use in the matter of discipleship and maybe even give to your unsaved friends. But then spiritual warfare on three fronts. Then we get into the center section of the book where it deals with what is the biblical theological evidence concerning can a Christian be inhabited by a demon? and I try to objectively deal with that, come to the conclusion that the Bible does not have sufficient information for us to make a declarative statement on the matter, and that we have to put together biblical picture and clinical pictures, like, can a Christian have cancer? The Bible doesn't say so, but you use the same reasoning processes concerning that as you do on the matter of, can a Christian be demonized? We do it every day. It's just that we have such emotional bias against this that we cannot clear our minds to understand the truth as it really is. Well, I deal with that. And then in this third section of the book, related matters, how do we defend ourselves? How do we help people along this line? And encouragements. So I hope that you're able to benefit by those.
Thank you. I had opportunities when I was in mission to visit many Bible colleges, and I'd always go in the bookstore into the theology department, and the Bible colleges across America are using this book as a textbook on angelology, as far as I know. There's major schools all across the nation. I wanted to give you a definition, and I left it out, and it's a definition of a stronghold. You want to write it down. This is from Taking Our Cities for God, and this is from Ed Sovoso. Ed Sovoso is Luis Palau, we said, brother-in-law, who has a ministry of going in and taking a city. But this is one of the most unbelievable, super definitions for a stronghold I've ever read. And remember where to cast them down. This is it. A stronghold is a mindset impregnated with hopelessness. A stronghold is a mindset impregnated with hopelessness that causes us to accept, that causes us to accept as unchangeable something that we know is contrary to the will of God. That's awesome. And you, in counseling, you get people that say, what? This is hopeless. I can't change. And yet God says they need to change. They need to be about a biblical change. Okay, a stronghold is a mindset impregnated with hopelessness that causes us to accept as unchangeable something that we know is contrary to the will of God. Until that stronghold comes down, there's not going to be a biblical change in the life of the person. Well, we have an out-of-print book that's on the table for sale. In the bookstore, some asked if they had any Victor Matthews, and they said, well, it was all out of print. Well, Victor brought some books. And Victor, would you come and share? There he is. Are they walking back and forth while I'm talking?
I'm sure you all realize that the real key to overcoming the enemy is not shouting at him, but the place of Jesus Christ in your life. Now, this little book is written to show an individual what it means to give the Lord Jesus rightful place, what the truth means, how to implement it in your daily life. Baker has taken this off the market, but I had a private printing made. I have priced it at less money than you would spend if you went to McDonald's. You can buy it for $3. If you need a lot of them, write to me in Grand Rapids, and I'll send them to you cheaper than that. So use them in discipleship. Learn how to give them away to people. If individuals do not know how to put off the old man, how to put on the new, how to take their place in the heavenlies, how to be filled with the Holy Spirit, no amount of time that you give to working with them are they ever going to be free. It's only Jesus Christ by the Holy Spirit through the truth will make people free. So I've written a little book as a foundation to show people what that means.
It's not listed in the bibliography because we didn't know that it was available. So it's called Personal Success. Is it in there? Well, I didn't realize I put it in there. If we allowed Neil to talk about all his books, I wouldn't have any time left for the kids. But most of you are familiar with The Bondage Breaker, and most of you are familiar with Victory Over the Darkness. I will not let anyone come for counseling that has not read Victory Over Darkness, because I found it cuts down just hours when they understand their position in Christ. It just cuts through a lot of the teaching and the working. But there may be some of these other books. In the newest book, I know that you're probably not aware of, many of you maybe didn't even know it was out yet, and that's Release from Bondage. And maybe Neil could share something about seduction of our children and walking through the darkness, but make a little focus on this, the new book out, Release from Darkness. When Neil sent me the book for free, and I like books that way, so if you write a book, send me one for free. And I read it. I started reading it, and it was time to go to bed, and I was very upset because I hadn't finished the book. And I knew I had to go to bed. I had a heavy counseling schedule, and the next day I finished it. So I called Neil, and he was teaching up at Trinity, and he said that on that book, that the people who got the early copies had read the book in 24 hours. So Neil, would you come and just, where is it? I don't trust him. Good. These three. Seduction.
I've read them.
Yeah. Oh.
Anyway, thanks, Jim. Seduction of our children was spun out of a need that as I was talking to adults, that I realized that most of their problems originated when they were children. And that really spurred me. I said, we got to stop this problem so people don't live 40, 50 years in desperation. Part of that was the research that we did in Southern California in the Christian Kids, and which maybe Jim will comment later on. I had Jim come out and do a video series with us that accompanies this particular book. But I'm telling you, it's alarming what is happening. This is Christian Kids. When you find out that 74% of those kids believe they're different from others, that Christianity works for other people, it doesn't work for them. That's not true. 71% say they're hearing voices. If they played a game like Dungeons and Dragons, 44% say they have impulsive thoughts to kill people. I mean, there's a battle going on for our minds, and unfortunately, our answer to it is clean up society, and I'm saying, it's not going to work. It's not going to work. The problem is not there, it's right here. And especially amongst some of our kids, and I think the classic scenario is a little child coming into mom and dad's room and saying, there's something in my room. So mom and dad go in there, look, honey, there's nothing here. And then they leave. Now, mom and dad, if you saw something in that room, would you go back in there? But you go back in there, kid. But anyway, and I said, we got story after story, illustration after illustration of helping a little child to know that Christ is in them and bigger than they are, and he can tell them to leave. And we're just seeing that happen all across the country. And if that child from that time knows that he has that authority in Christ and can resist the evil one, the rest of their life will be shaped by that confidence in the Lord. Walking Through the Darkness was another needed book, because so many people today, desiring to walk with the Lord, next thing you know, they're paying attention to some deceiving spirit or caught up in some false prophet. But how does God guide? It's not a negative book, it's a positive book. I didn't want the title, Walking Through the Darkness. I wanted it Walking in the Light, because that's what it really is. I mean, I really sympathize with Mark over here. He wanted a book on revival, but the title wouldn't sell, they said, so satanic revival. It's really a book on spiritual revival. So anyway, that was a necessary correlation, because I'm deeply committed that we got to learn to walk by the Spirit, learn to walk in the light, and to realize there's some hardships out there for us. But it's a book on divine guidance and how the Lord is guiding our life, interfacing with the reality of the new age world that we're living in. And Release from Bondage really was prompted by pastors. When I would share stories in conferences, and I get these huge letters from people, and they say, what are you going to do with those? And I said, well, I don't know. And it really came out of a need. It's one thing for me to tell you a story. It's another thing to hear it from their perspective. And I'm telling you, it has been a gripper of what these people have gone through. I mean, it's an emotional experience for me to reread this book. And yet, answers out of that thing. It's victorious. When I did my doctorate of ministry class at Trinity about 3-4 weeks ago, it's the first time I had this book out. It just came out. In fact, it was just sent right there for that purpose. And a few students, you know, halfway through the week said, wait a minute, these are Christians. I mean, you know, one's a pastor's wife, one's a pastor, and you know. And this, I hope it'll help people to realize this is going on in our churches and all over our churches. When I do conferences and across the country, man, you can't believe the problems that we surface. And oftentimes the pastors say, I don't think we have these problems in our church. Oh, yeah, you do. But the beautiful part about it is that Christ is the answer, and truth sets people free.
When someone comes for counseling, I try to remember to give them a book called How to Worship Jesus Christ as a free thing. Our counseling center does not charge for those that come for counseling with a demonic problem. And so we give them this book. It's written by Joseph Carroll. It's now printed by Moody Press, and with John MacArthur doing the title. And then we've got another little book that I like to put in their hand. It is called Looking Unto Jesus. Because I believe that every attack of the enemy, one of the main reasons for that attack is to get my eyes off of Christ, onto my circumstances, but worse, usually, into myself. And when I start focusing in myself, there's no hope there. Is there hope within you? You know, my hope is not within me. And all of a sudden, the enemy gets my eyes in the wrong place, and I begin to sink. And so this book, a little teeny book, it's so powerful. Just looking unto Jesus. When you have a heartache, look unto Jesus. And some scripture verses. It's a very simple little book, but it's been very helpful to those that are going through some real tremendous trials. Okay, the little one is Theodore Mund, M-O-N-D, and it's printed by Bible Light Publishers in Hong Kong. A trip to Hong Kong, you can buy one for a quarter. I'm sure a bookstore can, and it's not in the book, because I just got this. I don't believe it's listed in there. Tom White is not here, but I'm going to refer to some of the material in Tom White's book in dealing with children. It's a very practical book. Tom White will be here. He's just not here right now. Tom is coming in today. But this book you may find very helpful. It's got a lot of practical things in the back, how-tos, dealing with certain aspects and certain type things. I got a call asking if I would read a manuscript before the conference. And I said I would love to read the manuscript before the conference. And so the manuscript came last Friday. I was overwhelmed. We thought it was three of them. One for each of us, but it was just one for me. This is called A Handbook on Spiritual Warfare. It's 7 inches high. I did finish it by Monday. The author of this new book, it's not out yet. They hope to condense it a little and put a cover around it. It also doubles for one of those chairs if the kids don't quite reach. Dr. Ed Murphy, would you come and tell us what will I find in this book?
Well, Jim, maybe you can tell me because I haven't read it yet. I just wrote it. And that's no joke. He really has received more of it from the publisher than I have, too. Well, it's called The Handbook, and I didn't put that title on it. I would never use the word The Handbook on Spiritual Warfare. Basically, let me give you the background to it. When I first got involved in so-called deliverance ministry as a missionary, it was really an involvement with my own daughter, which I talk about in my tape series. And then I got involved in another situation in which Dr. Dick Hillis, the founder of Overseas Crusades, my mission, was involved. And then I ended up on Biola Talbot campus before Neil Anderson got there, and got involved in some incredible power encounters, deliverance ministry with Biola and Talbot students, and even with some faculty, which no one knows about because I've never written about that. But I remember I got into all kinds of trouble, and probably some of it I brought on myself because I'm an impulsive, outspoken person. I don't mean outspoken in a negative sense, but I just, if something happens, it happens. And so I got called in by the faculty, by the administration right down the line, and about the fact that I was not supposed to be casting demons out of the students of Biola and Talbot. And there were three things that were said to me that really struck me. One is one of the administrators said to me, "Ed, were there any demons here before you got here?"
I'm leaving.
No, I'm not going to talk long. No. Okay. I see. And I said, I didn't put them here. I just found them. And then the second thing was a meeting with all of the faculty in the theology department of Biola and Talbot. Again, Neil wasn't here to defend me at that time. And the third was a meeting with the Department of Psychology. And The result of that is I had to begin to go back and reflect on what I was doing, and then out of that came the tape series, Spiritual Warfare, which is, there are some out there. And I got a lot of requests then, and even a request from three publishers to take the tape series and to put it into book form. And I said, no, the tape series goes so far, but I believe there are deeper issues that have to be dealt with. And what I am interested in is doing what I call a beginning definitive study that would deal with the primary issue that we faced in this whole area, which we call a worldview issue. I don't remember if you last year you were here when you heard Dr. Matthew speak so marvelously on the impact of the Enlightenment on our theology. Western theology is as much Enlightenment oriented, unfortunately, as it is biblically oriented. I don't mean to be negative, but that's true. And then, so the first section of the book deals with an in-depth look at the whole question of how you see reality and why, and how that filters out the spirit world. Then secondly, the theological section just deals with an overview, like many of the men have done, on the area of the warfare motif of Scripture, what I call the spiritual warfare dimensions of a biblical worldview, and deals with what Dr. Bubeck will be talking about this week, the world, the flesh, and the devil. And why can't you live the Christian life as you should because of these various problems? Then I go into a strongly exegetical section, and that was the thing I really wanted to do, because we were constantly being criticized that what we're doing is not rooted in Scripture. It's rooted in experience. And by the way, one of my first chapters, I take this contrast between experience and the Word of God and show that that is totally without any biblical foundation. There is no such thing as a knowledge of God apart from experience. And there's no such thing as a true biblical exegesis that does not filter through experience. And experience and the Word of God are never in conflict in Scripture. And this is what Fred told us in his book, but they harmonize. So I started really from Genesis and went on through to Revelation. And when I ended up, Jim, I told Jim last night, I think I had 1,200 pages. And the publisher wasn't very happy with that. And most of it was an exegesis. And so the problem has been cutting it down. But I tried to deal with every major passage in the Old Testament. I had to take some groups of books together in the New Testament as to what is the biblical worldview reflected in statements. And if you don't know the background to the worldview motif and the power motif of the culture at that time, those statements are filtered out of our understanding. But I came out of it with a strong conviction. I'm going to touch on some of it tomorrow night, that what we are doing is rooted in Scripture, and it can be proven if we understand the context in which Scriptures were written, which was this spirit world worldview context that we have lost. And then the last part of the book is a practical section that could have gone on and on. But there I had a strong chapter on the demonization of Christians. It's the six major causes, usually avenues, and this is transcultural, that bring demonic powers into the lives of believers, before they're believers or even after they're believers. And then one of them particularly I focused on was the area of child abuse, which I know all of us are involved in counseling, and I gave some heartbreaking studies in that area, but trying to hold before the people of God that the children of today are being destroyed for tomorrow, and unless we can reach the children and adult survivors of this complex situation, unless the church knows what is going on, we're going to have an awful time in the days ahead. And then finally, I went into some sections that I think are crucial to all of us, the relationship between so-called psychological, mental, emotional problems, and demonic problems. And I used some case studies in there and ended up with what I call the way of victory in spiritual warfare. So it's a textbook style that has a double focus towards the thinking critical leader and scholar, but it's filled with so many case studies that it can be read by lay people who have a grasp of Scripture and an openness to the Word of God. So that's basically what it's all about.
I've never read a book on warfare that goes through book by book by book of the New Testament with everything in that book that deals with the enemy dealt with as he's done in this book. It's really an awesome book. We have a couple of free things for you. One is A Hard Look at Satanism, and this is written for the teenager. And the author is here, and he's made these available, and they're Bart Larson, and they're at the table where the book on Satan is, so everybody can have one of these. And then I don't have a lot, but if you're working with children, when I was at CEF, I asked, why don't we design a track on warfare for children? So we did design a track, and I didn't know if you've seen it. A lot of people don't even know what's out there, but there is a full-color track for children, a very simple track, just warning them about the enemy. And so that will be on my table with the resources, and you can look at that. We just have a few minutes to get to start into the children. They asked me to do a half hour, and then I just wrote down some things, and I ended up with tons. I just got back, as I said, from Maui, and when I was there, I had an opportunity. I was just supposed to do a seminar, preach Sunday morning, Sunday night, and do a seminar at night for anybody on the island, and then run a special seminar during the day for pastors or counselors who wanted to help people who were losing. So the night was positive, the daytime, and then they threw in what I meet with the teachers at a Christian school, what I teach to the kids at Christian school, counseling all day long, and what I speak to youth groups. I said, sure. So we had a, if you notice, I'm just as white as when I went over. And the interesting thing was, in the Christian school, as Neil has found, I found the same thing. Young people who were afraid, people that were sleeping in the living room with the lights on because they're afraid of the spirits, they're in the house. Kids that are seeing things, kids that are hearing voices in the Christian school. I did not talk in the public schools in Maui, just Christian schools. And you say, well, is this really going on? Have you ever asked? See, the mission that runs the school hadn't asked. And it was like, did I bring the demons and give the... No, these kids saw the demons before I showed up. And they were living in fear, but no one ever addressed the issue. The kids never said anything. You know, they, do you walk around saying, you know, I hear voices? Or we've got this something in our bedroom, you ought to see it. At night with the lights off, it's the only time. And it's unbelievable. So I want to share, I want to go through some of these things that we found very helpful. It's amazing, in my counseling, I counsel two groups of people. Mostly I counsel men. Secondly, children and teenagers. Then thirdly, women. And everybody I see flies in from another state. So the people I see at the counseling center are those that fly in from other countries or fly in from other states. And I was amazed as I looked, it's mostly men that are coming, and then kids. So thank God, I guess a lot of counseling centers, they're having a lot more women coming for help, but we're seeing, or I'm seeing, a majority are men coming. The first thing we want to deal with, and that is the ancestral aspect, and we've got a few minutes, and I think we can get through this one. This ancestral situation is really a tremendous problem. I think Fred Dickinson said something like, was 95, Fred, the people that you see, their problem started with ancestral spirits. But remember, there comes a point in a child's life where it's no longer an ancestral problem, it's his problem. You with me? You know, God holds me personally responsible for the choices that I make, but the influence on that child or in that family is coming down through ancestors. We had a deal with a fellow that was in full-time Christian ministry who was arrested where he was living. I don't even want to identify even what continent or whatever. And his wife went to get him. She had come back to the United States, went to get him, went to the jail, and found him wearing her clothes. So they came back to the States. I was burdened for this fellow. I was new into warfare, but I was got into warfare by a missionary that was demonized, and I didn't believe in it. In fact, Chuck Lynch is here, who I picked as taking my place at Calvary Bible College as a counseling teacher. And when I left Calvary, if someone would have told me I'd be doing this, I'd have told them they're crazy, because I'm a conservative fundamentalist, and we don't believe in these things. Except in the Bible. But I came short, and so here is this fellow. So I was burdened for him. I called him on the phone, and I just, you know, what do? The fellow doesn't know me, doesn't know who I am, and I call this guy in the United States and say, you know, I think you have demons. It's not exactly, but I just said this, and this is not a bad statement to say. Have you ever considered the possibility of enemy involvement in your problem? That's not a bad question. Have you ever considered the possibility of enemy involvement in your problem? And he said, absolutely not. I'm of whatever group it is, and Christians kind of have demonic problems. And I said, fine. But I said, I think you ought to really rethink this. And I said, just see how well you do with your counseling. So 4 years later, this fellow calls 3 weeks while I was gone, or three times in a week while I was gone. And he said, I've come to the conclusion that my problem has enemy involvement. And the fellow came, and in a week's time, this cross-dresser, we've had a number of them come, was set free. This fellow is being discipled by a young man who's here's father, and who I trained in warfare, that lives in that area of the state where he's from. And the reports I'm getting of this fellow has been absolutely wonderful. But the first time he ever put on women's clothing that he can remember was when he was in the crib, when his mother laid her underwear on the bed, and he remembers putting on her underwear and falling asleep in the crib. Can you explain that? Where does a little child begin to have perverted concepts and ideas if there isn't an ancestral thing involved? Another illustration, I'd like to use it because, you know, I'm not a sponge. It's really hard for me to believe what I was seeing. And I went really slow. I went to Moody Bible Institute, and Fred Dickinson trained me in deliverance. And on the way back, I told my wife I would never do it. It was just too difficult, and I wasn't going to do it. And then the Lord forced me. Even after I had the training, I felt less wanting to do it. But what was interesting, just to let you know the reality of this ancestral stuff, we had a woman come to our home. My wife and I dealt with her. And as we were doing the power encounter at that time, addressing the spirits and writing down in that approach, and this woman was sharing the demons that were in here. We found out which ones were ancestral, and we were writing them down. That very same week, unbeknownst to the mother, her child was sitting in Fred Dickinson's office at Moody Bible Institute going through deliverance with Fred Dickinson. And guess what ancestral spirits Fred found were the exact same ones we found 1,000 miles away. And I had to believe there's some reality here. And then they didn't know about it till the parent and child talked to each other later on, because neither one of them known they had come for counseling. And then I want to share, in closing for this part, the father's here, and I said, I'm going to use you as an illustration. I didn't know he was coming. I'm going to use you and your family as an illustration. He said it was okay. I told him he could slide down in his seat, so the guy that slid down in front of you, that's who it is. This fellow's in Christian ministry. He came to our mission, and we had rooms set aside in a lodge where I would see missionaries and Christian leaders from other missions. The first 200 people I led to freedom were missionaries or pastors. I'd never dealt with anybody that wasn't. It was all Christian workers because I was involved as the vice president of the mission. Well, this fellow came and his wife, and while they were there, they came to the conclusion that their family, their children, must have some ancestral demonic situations. And so we're going to get in how do you deal with kids and how you, but I'm just going to share this and we'll close with this because it's so neat. They had, and I don't know, the father's looking at me and I may have the kids wrong, but let me just guess. 8, 5, and 2. I may be off, but if you can pick the kids at that age. And they said, you know, we want to deal with the kids while we're here. And I said, no, the Lord will let you know the right time to deal with the kid. Let me give you Tom White. Remember, I recommended the book. Let me give you Tom White's material on how to deal with children. And when the Lord makes that ideal time, pray with them and follow the guidelines in Tom White's material. I said, fine. Well, I went home. The next day, they said, oh, you should have been here. Last night was really something. He said, after you left, our oldest boy woke up. He came across the hall and he was crying and he said, Dad, I had that terrible dream again. And the dad said, what dream was that? He said, the dream that the whole family was dead. And the dad said, and the dad had gone through deliverance himself that week. And the dad said to the son, son, and I don't know why he asked this, I don't think he even knows why, did you dream that we all died or did you dream that you killed us? I dreamed I killed you. He sat the boy down, and here's a father who'd just been through deliverance himself, did not have any, you know, really hadn't probably even read the material, sat down with that boy, And he prayed and commanded in the name and the authority of Christ that any spirits on his child, because of him or through the family or any other reason, would leave. And here this kid didn't know, no preparation, no anything. The kid didn't know anything. The dad prayed. You know what the kid said? He looked at his dad and he said, "They're not all gone yet." He prayed again. He said, "Dad, they're gone." So they decided this was the time. They went over to the little boy that was laying in the bed. They took Tom's prayer, I believe, and they read the prayer, and they said, "Jim, we wish you would have been here as we read this prayer over our sleeping son." He was thrown from one side of the bed to the other. We thought he was going to be thrown on the floor, back and forth while we read this prayer. And then the end of the prayer, command him to go. He just kept on sleeping. The next day, that little guy got up, and you know what he said to his dad? He didn't know that they prayed for him. He said, "Dad, I don't hear those voices anymore." They didn't know he heard voices. That's not the end. Remember, there's a two-year-old? On the way back, as they're going back to where they came from, as they were traveling, every time the mom would turn around in the back to give the baby a bottle or change his diaper or whatever, this two-year-old would look at her and stiffen out and scream. You know, they called it making strange, but usually don't do it with your mother. It would just do this. And they stayed overnight with a couple, and they were driving back, and she was turning around the second day, and this baby screamed and stiffened out. And the dad said, "That's it." And he pulled the car over off the shoulder in the freeway and turned around and said, "In the name and authority of Christ, you get out of my son." The mom turned around, the kid smiled, and gave him a bottle. That's the first. The first thing we have to deal with children is what? The ancestral sense. And I think it's time for lunch. Let's bow in prayer, and we'll pick up after lunch. Father, we thank you, as Mark shared today, about your power. And we think of these little ones who are coming under tremendous attack because of the ground mom and dad have given. And these kids who are faced with a battle that they don't fully understand, and many of them are crumbling under that battle. But we're thankful for the authority that we have in Christ and the authority that parents have. And Lord, we pray as we continue to study of children and the various ways they come under attack and how that we might help them, that the little ones might be free of all kinds of demonic influence upon them and upon their lives. We thank you, Father, for what you're going to do and what we're going to learn. And Father, we pray that we might learn one from another. If there are those here who have been skillful in a lot of practice with children, that we might learn how to deal with the child in a way that would not scare him or cause the child to fear the enemy, but the child might see their authority and position in Christ. Thank you for the opportunities we've had this morning, and we're asking that we'd have tremendous fellowship around the table. In Christ's name, we pray. I just, as when they asked me to do this, I just got alone and I just prayed, and what happened was the Lord brought children to my mind. And I just listed down all, you know, the children that came up, and then what was the situation, and then I tried to put it together. And so it may not be logically, it's just, these are just issues you have to deal with children. The second issue, we talked about the ancestral one that's got to be dealt with. The second issue that was a real problem to me to deal with is how young, right? What age can you take a child through deliverance? How young? Well, I had not dealt with a child, and I was dealing with a family. And there was a teenager, and I thought, well, a teenager's no problem, you know, that they're old. And so I dealt with a parent, I dealt with a teenager, and then there was the seven-year-old. And I thought, well, I'll probably damage him for the rest of his life with some kind of trauma if I do this. So I wasn't going to do it. And the seven-year-old looked at me and he said, "Mr. Logan, are you going to make me keep my demons?" He knew how to hurt it. So I thought, oh Lord, I don't want to damage this kid. Let's go with this. So we dealt with him, and all of a sudden I realized the younger they are, the easier it is. And if you deal with children, you find the younger they are, the easier. They just believe. And they just believe what God says. I have an opportunity every year to speak to legislators, congressmen, senators, judges, lawyers, and so on. It's really a tremendous opportunity. Last year, one of our, I don't want to identify what he was, but anyway, a man involved in public government came up to me and said, I would like to tell you what happened. We were, our son and daughter were in a major city, got involved in a good Bible preaching church. An older couple came up, they had a 2-year-old boy and the wife was pregnant. An older couple came up and offered to be grandparents while, you know, your parents are away. Isn't that a nice opportunity and all? So they would even said they would be willing to babysit. Well, after the baby was born, in the first 2 months of the baby's life, they didn't realize, but when this couple would babysit them, this older couple, they were Satanists. And this newborn baby was ritually sexually abused, not every day, because you don't go every day, but for the first 2 months of its life. Now, they tried to go to trial and all of this, and I don't want to go into that because we don't have very much time, and I want to share a lot of things. But anyway, what happened was, this is 2 years later now, 2.5 years later, the older boy is explaining the behavior of the one who was abused this first 2 months of its life, now that it's 2 years old. And he said, oh, the reason he's doing that, that's when they put him in the oven. And the reason he's doing this, this is what they did to him. And so you have even little, or we're getting little ones that we're going to need to deal with. We had a sad telephone call. And the family knows, they called me this week. I talked to them. But their 4-year-old daughter took a rope, tied it around her neck, and tried to hang herself. She tied knots that she doesn't know how to tie. But how many 4-year-olds can tie a hang type thing and hang themselves? But this 4-year-old was ritually sexually abused in satanic rituals by her grandfather. And she's gone through all kinds of struggles. She went to a pediatrician that happened to know me in another state that told the family they needed to see me. Then they went to a church in another state where they moved to get away from these people. And the pastor there said, you need to call Jim Logan. They thought, well, this has got to be of God. You know, my doctor in one state, pediatrician, said, call Jim Logan, and they did. So they called me. When the girl tried to hang herself, we had her put into a place that does specialize with the SRA children. And they seem to do a very good job with children. But after she got through there, they're sure she's not a multiple. She doesn't show anything because she's talking about it. And she's able to talk about everything that took place with her mom and so on. So in ritual abuse, and I want to put this, I didn't even lay the thing out there with children. I've got to apologize to you. There is no copier in the machine, or no copy machine in the building. So if you want a copy, this is the children's stuff, you know, the some of the things we put together here. But one of the things we had them do, here's a child, 4 years old, that was involved in ritual satanic abuse. I'm looking for a special page here. When the father got saved through this, and that's really exciting, and I've been able to, in a way, disciple him over the telephone. It's been really neat. As a dad shares the scriptures he's learning, and he's into the Word and all this. And so God is being honored through this terrible thing that took place in this family. But I said, I think the whole family ought to be dedicated to the Lord. Is step number one. You know, it's never been set apart to the Lord. Wanted this whole family. So when they told the little girl they were going to dedicate the family, she didn't want to be, and they said, why? And she said, I don't want to drink blood again. Or, well, I have to drink blood again. Little 4-year-old. So all the stories and things she's telling, but one of the best people to deal with a child is the mother. Because you can't force a child to talk. The worst thing you do is try to get the kids to talk about what happened to them. What you need to do is to allow them to talk. And when they want to say something, a mother needs to squat down, love the child, and listen. You know, what are they saying? And isn't that terrible? And all that kind of thing. But Neil Anderson, in his new book, has here satanic ritual abuse. All the things that on one side that happens in satanic ritual. And he countered it with biblical truth on the other side. And so what I had these parents do, since this little girl couldn't do this, the first one is, I renounce ever signing my name over to Satan or having my name signed over to Satan. I announce that my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. See, and they go through the satanic stuff and make a renunciation. But since a 4-year-old couldn't do that, guess who did it? Mom and Dad. Because the little girl has trusted Christ. And they went through and read this, that they wanted to break any kind of curse, blessing, or whatever was done to this little girl. So they went through and they followed this, and I believe this is entirety now. It's a little more involved in the book on children that Neil has in his new book, Release from Bondage. It's in here, you can see that. So we had them do that, and then we talked to this little girl about God's power, because they were sending spirits to her. You say, how do they do that? I don't know how they do that. But they were sending spirits to where this, wherever they moved, guess what would happen? Spirits would come into the bedroom. And she knew when they were there. She would tell the parents they were there. And so guess what the parents had to do? They had to teach a four-year-old how to send the spirits back. One of the things, she had night terrors. And that's another key. Nightmares and night terrors. There's a difference between the two. But they used this for this little girl, and the little girl wanted me to have this as a gift. And that sleep sound in Jesus. I don't know if you've heard this, but they play this every single night for this little girl to go to sleep. And it's all about how angels protect you and all that. Because that little girl's afraid that those bad people are going to find her and do some of the most hideous things that you could possibly do to a little child that's been done to this girl. And she's always afraid that they're going to find out where she is and one day take her away and put her in the cages and do all the stuff they did to her. So she listens to this every night. And this was a major breakthrough for her. So if you've never heard it, it's by Michael Card. And it's just, and she wanted me to have a special thing. And she says, now, she calls me Jim. She says, Jim, when you listen to this, you won't have nightmares anymore. So you listen to this every night. You want to explain every question with a little child like that. You know, as they have questions, try to answer the questions. And if you don't know, have the parents call you. But we thought, does she really need to come to our office? But she really wanted to come. And so she did come, and immediately she was drawn to me. We didn't think she would be, because I'm a grandfather 7 times, and it was a grandfather that did it. But she just took to me right away and loved me and touched me, and she let me hug her, and the parents were amazed, because this is something that didn't happen. And so I prayed over her. The parents, I shared with them how to pray using Tom's material. I prayed over this little girl. She was in the office, and she is doing really well, considering where she's come from. Unbelievably well. She doesn't have these night terrors anymore. Spirits don't come in that bedroom anymore to attack her as they did. And the folks didn't know what was going on. She'd wake up screaming about things, and you know, she couldn't quite talk and pointing. And they didn't know what was going on. But here they were sending these spirits to her, and she knew they were from her grandfather. She said, oh, this is a spirit from grandpa's son. So she was a four-year-old that we dealt with her, and using the proper music. And then the last one that we dealt with, the youngest one possible. Man, our time is going. The youngest one possible was a woman who came to my Sunday school class one day. I was putting things together, and she was a brand new person in the St. Louis area, and she was pregnant. And I looked at the lady, and I said, is your husband parking the car? And she said, I'm not married. You know, what do I say next? You know what I said? And the Lord gave it to me. I said, you made the right choice. And she smiled. She was so afraid of rejection. First time in a church. And here she goes to a church pregnant and not married. And so the Lord allowed her to develop a real relationship with my wife. And because of the circumstances surrounding this child and everything, she came to the home. And in our home, we decided we would pray and break any kind of ancestral or any kind of, because of the conception. And when we prayed for this lady and prayed against any kind of spirits associated with that child, I got frightened. When I prayed and I commanded any spirits associated with the child to leave, when I said that, the baby leaped in her womb and the woman grabbed her sides. So, you know, if you go back in literature, you find that when a baby was baptized at a baptismal fount, all the way back, and I've got all of these books that I've read, you'll find that they dealt with ancestral demons at the baptismal fount. And they prayed against this. The early church did this. This continually prayed against. It's become a ritual now, but there was a time it was meaningful. And so just even a baby in the womb can be dedicated to Christ. And any kind of ancestral thing can be removed from it, even in a womb. Okay, one of the tools that we found in dealing with a child that I think is very important, this is moving into another area now, and that is we need to check out the child's salvation. We're dealing with a child, we want to be sure that they know who the Lord is. And we used a tool, and there's people here that are very skillful from the mission I was in. If you know what this is, you know what's connected with the mission I was a part of. It's a wordless book. And the wordless book is an excellent tool. It explains the gospel. It explains you know, where God is and no sin can go there. It talks about this page where it talks about sin, talks about the blood of Christ, how his work on the cross, and how that you could be washed and have the righteousness of Christ and you need to grow. I'm giving you a real quickie. But you can also use this as a warfare tool and teach spiritual warfare with the same book, right? What about Jude? What's it say about those who those spirits of darkness and so on in the book of Jude? The finished work of Christ, the righteousness of Christ to stand against them and so on. And so we use this tool. We had a missionary's grandkids come to our office, and they thought there may be some demonic problem because of their dad, because the kids were having nightmares and all of this. And I'll never forget, we had a real, the best kind of gal to be on the telephone when you call to an organization. She was so friendly. She'd say, oh, is it raining in Hong Kong? And, you know, what's happening in Switzerland? And it's raining here. It was a kind of a nut, and she had balloons and suckers. And the kids just loved going to her desk. And so she was with this little girl, the oldest of these girls. I think it was like 4 and 3 or 5 and 3, just little kids, preschoolers. I walked in, this girl didn't know who I was. When I walked in, she went, ah! And our girl went, oh no. She's sitting there just petrified, looking at this little five-year-old doing this horrible thing at me. And I'm going, I've had adults do things like that, especially after finals, but not a little kid like that. And that little girl wouldn't look at me. She would duck her head. She would do all kinds of things. It was terrible. I went through the wordless book. Her mother was holding her. I went through this book. Her, you know, she's a granddaughter of missionaries. I went through this little book, and I shared, you know, Jesus would like to come in your heart. And she said, I don't want him, with a different voice. The mother's crying, holding this little child with this voice coming out of it. It didn't want Christ. It was a little kid. But you know that we prayed over those children when they were sleeping, both of them, using the prayer that Tom White has in his book. I said, just, you have authority, you're the mother, pray over your child when they're sleeping and break any of this. Both little children after that received the Lord. The grandmother was out in the hall, this little girl that would do this stuff and hide her head and do horrible gestures at me, ran down the hall and put her arms around my leg and put her head on my leg, and the grandmother came out and saw it and started crying. And this little girl that was so against all this, check out their salvation. We had a girl that the family had spent $72,000 in counseling in 2 years. She was a teenager, graduated from a Christian school, got the highest award for the Christian character and so on. This girl, when she came to our mission for help, had not had on regular clothes for 6 months. Her mother has permanent scars. Her dad teaches in a Bible college. Her mother has permanent scars on her arm where she would try to push her daughter into a shower, but if the voices didn't tell her she could shower, she would fight her mother. She would stand and go to the bathroom on the floor if the voices didn't tell her she could go. And I was really concerned. I mean, she was the worst case that I've ever seen. She had been in 6 mental hospitals and had seen 16 psychiatrists. And I thought, what can I do for this girl? I mean, she's been everywhere. She's been to all of them, and I didn't know what to do. But I thought, at least I can check out her salvation. So we got her out by the lake. She sat down, and I went through this book. And she says, oh, I know that. They got her dressed. She was dressed. And she says, oh, I know that. She said, that's the wordless book. I've led people to Christ with that book. I said, oh. I said, you know, it's also a book on warfare. And I talked about the forces of darkness. And I quoted the thing in Jude. And I went to the finished work of Christ. This girl stood up, fell on her knees, and began to bang her head in the dirt as hard as she could, as far, smashing her head in the dirt. When I would pray against the enemy, she would smash harder and harder and harder. If I would stop praying, she would stop smashing. And I'm crying, because I'm hurting this girl. I'm trying to help her, and I'm hurting her. Well, I wasn't hurting her. The enemy looked like, what am I doing here? If I don't do anything and just let her wander around in this Neverland, she's better off than me trying to deal with her, because look what the enemy's doing to this girl. And so I said to this girl, I said, you know, I prayed against the enemy. And she said, sir, Christians cannot have demonic problems. From her teaching. And she said, how do you know God doesn't want me to hit my head in the dirt? And I knew, and I had to run and get my Bible, which was blocks away at the mission from the lake, and ran back with my Bible because I had the answer. And I knelt down and I said, and she's still with her head in the dirt, but she wasn't smashing it. And she said, I said, you know, Jesus doesn't want your head in the dirt. She says, how do you know? And I read about the little boy rolling in the dirt where Jesus reached down and lifted him out of the dirt. I said, Jesus doesn't push your head in the dirt. And she struggled because she had a Bible background. Here Jesus is lifting him out of the dirt. The voices are telling her to smash herself in the dirt. Can these voices really be of God? And that was the beginning of the breakthrough for that girl, when she began to believe that those voices she was hearing were not true. She had to begin to see that those were lies. Okay, let's see what else here. Okay, here's another one. Occult involvement. There must be a renunciation of occult involvement. We had a missionary's son come, and we have them do a renunciation. We give check sheets. We mark every kind of an occult kind of experience someone can have, or games and all of that, to see where these people are coming from. And when I said, I have them read Revelation 12, where Satan was overcome, the accuser of the brethren, and so on, or is it 10 or 12 in there in Revelation? And where it says, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and what? The word of their testimony. And I wanted him to give his testimony out loud that he wanted nothing to do with the enemy or his powers or empowering or any of that. And he looked at me and I thought, he's like sitting there and I'm going, I'm not a complicated person. That couldn't have been that complicated. And I said, well, we just read this. And I said, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, the word of their testimony. Would you just give your testimony? I already know that you're a Christian. You gave me that. Would you give your testimony that you don't want any of this empowering in your life and you renounce any of the satanic involvement and so on? And he looked at me, a missionary son, and said, if I do that, I'll be like everybody else. And I said, you're right. And he wouldn't do it. And we stopped the procedures. He liked the empowering that he had in his life, and to use that power over others. We had a young man. I was doing some summer missionaries, and I was not teaching on warfare at all. This kid didn't hear anything on it. I was just teaching, and the thing I taught was on not grieving the Spirit of God and being a Spirit-filled person so they could have dynamic in their spirit summer ministries. This kid was about 14 at the time. He's now in college, but he's 14 at the time, and he started crying. I didn't say anything that would make anybody cry. And a teenager to cry in front of other teenagers just isn't normal. And so afterwards, I went over and I said, are you having struggles? He said, oh, I'm okay, I'm okay. And I somehow just couldn't buy that. So I sat down on the platform. It kind of had steps, waiting until they got through all the stuff. It was kind of late at night. I went over to this kid and I said, can I help you? Out of the blue, this kid said, well, I used to play Dungeons and Dragons. And I said, oh, that's, you know, amazing. I've got a 60-minute thing in my office here at the mission that's an expose of D&D. I said, would you like to watch it? He said, sure. So we sat in there and we watched this thing. How many kids killed themselves? You've probably seen it. You know, the whole thing that 60 Minutes did, or one of those TV things. So he watched it, and then he said, well, I really wasn't that truthful with you. He said, I not only played D&D, I was a dungeon master. And I thought, well, I've heard that every dungeon master probably is demonized. You get that far in the game, you've probably picked up some demons. So I asked the kid, and I said, would you allow me to pray for you? Now, he had already said, well, I got rid of the board, I got rid of the dice, they got funny dice, I got rid of all my books. He said, I got rid of that a year ago. I don't have any of that stuff anymore. And I said, well, would you allow me to just pray with you? And we'll just pray against any kind of an attachment that the enemy may have taken because of the game. He said, fine. So he's sitting there, the chair has arms on it, and he said, let's pray. I could used to do this, but I can't anymore. And he bowed down and he put his head between his knees, you know how kids do, and his arms are hitting the floor. And I just started praying, Lord Jesus, you know, just be with it. I didn't ask God's protection, I didn't think we needed it. And I just said, Lord, if there's, you know, any attachment, and all of a sudden it was, bam! The kid was thrown backwards. It's like someone slugged him. He was thrown backwards in the chair. The chair went up. I thought he was going to go clear over. It came down. When it came down, his head went up. His eyes rolled in his head, and he started gurgling. I mean, just like that. It was just, poof. And I just said, I didn't know what else to do. It was just quick. In the name of Jesus, leave him alone. And he said, did you see that? I said, yeah, I was sitting right here. I saw the whole thing. He says, wow, that was powerful. He said, man, I got to go tell my youth group. I said, no, I don't think so. I don't think they're ready for that. And so we knew a kid from the youth group, and he came and said, you won't believe this. He said, man, he said, Mr. Logan started praying for me, and I was thrown backwards in this chair, and he said, it was like someone slugged me, and he said, my head went up, and he said, it was awful. And he said, now I'm okay. And he said, I think I ought to tell the youth group about this, because I don't think you ought to. But isn't that tragedy? that kids have experienced, and they can't share with other Christian kids, freedom. As long as in bondage, it's okay in the youth group. But for him to share that God did a work in his life, he can't be shared. But the reason I shared that one with you, which is important, is why did the kid have a problem? He took D&D stuff, and he threw it away. He got rid of all the occult stuff. Why did he have a problem? Because he didn't fulfill all of James 4:6, right? He submitted to God in the area of the stuff. He got rid of it, but what didn't he do? He didn't take back the ground or resist the enemy. And so the enemy didn't go anywhere until I prayed. I mean, I'm learning. I mean, I never had that before. I never had it since. We had another kid, I could tell you, a missionary kid that played a homemade Ouija board 3 times, and for 4 months, all I could think about was killing himself. That's unbelievable. We're running out of time. Objects. Oh, man. Invisible friends. Let me go to invisible friends, and maybe we pick up objects. I'm looking at the time here. Questions to ask. Here are questions to ask about invisible friends. First of all, and you don't ask this right off to kids, but I ask this to kids, I have a lot of things from all over the world in my office, and I show them this is from the Apache Indians, and this is from that, and this is from Israel, and they like it. But I ask these kids, do you ever hear things that no one else hears? And they'll sometimes say, yeah. And then I ask them, do you ever see things that no one else sees? And we had a missionary son, 8 years old, sitting on my couch, and he said, yes. And I said, what do you see? He said, my friend right here. And he had an invisible friend that was not really invisible. It wasn't a make-believe friend. It was a friend that I couldn't see, that he could see. And what are they? Spirit guides. And they grow up with the kids. We get a lot of this. But no one ever asks this question. And so he said, but there's nothing wrong with them. I said, well, how do you know? He said, because he never tells me to do anything wrong. Now what do I do? Because if I send him away, what's going to happen? He's either not going to go anywhere, or he's going to wait out in the hall for him when he leaves. This kid had to send him away. The 7-year-old boy had to send the spirit guide away. And so, you know, the Lord is on our side, and he does marvelous things. And what he did is, and this kid only knew I was a talk doctor, and he'd get no shots. So he's really excited. He could talk to me, and he wasn't going to get any shots, so he didn't mind being there. So we were talking, and what happened in the midst of all this was all of a sudden he looked troubled. And I said, what's wrong? He said, my friend just told me something. I said, what did he tell you? He said, get up and leave, and we'll go play. Whatever you do, don't let this man pray for you. I said, do you think that's of God? He said, no. I said, why don't you pray and say, if this is not of God, then I command you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to leave and to go. So he did. I said, what happened? He said, well, he went out the door. He didn't open it, just went right through it. But he went out. And that kid was there for 3 more days, and it never came back. And I could go on and on. You need to tell a child who they are in Christ. If you got my last prayer letter, you got the story of the Dallas Seminary grad that's in Africa, the 7-year-old girl who was being attacked physically by demons. They were raping her since the time she was 4 years old until she was 7 years old. Demons were coming almost every night, and she'd go into a stupor and all of this. Well, anyway, this was going through a terrible thing. And so the Dallas Seminary graduate guy, really a neat guy, came to our counseling center just for 1 week to sit in on the counseling thing, because I can't go back to Africa and not know how to deal with this. So he sat with a week and counseling with me just in the office. So he's gone back, and he said, you know, that if he sent the demons away, this would not be significant. He had to get the girl. The girl had to send him away. So he began to teach her who she was in Christ, and then she began to send the demons away. And the demons would only come to the front door, and they couldn't come in. Now, she lived in Abidjan, and her family lived out in a village. And the sorcerer who was sending these demons was a distant cousin that were sending these spirits to attack her. And so there's miles. And the sorcerer sent a friend in when this girl began to resist and said, you must bring the girl back to the village. We must resolve our conflict. What conflict? Here's a girl in a major city resisting the spirits he's sending. But he knew she was doing it back in the village. He wasn't in the city because the demons could not get to her, and he wanted her. Well, since he was a relative, he started dying, and I just got to end with this story. He started dying, and what they did is they said, told her mother, I want you to bring your daughter from the city out to the village. And this is after Steve worked and worked with this girl through Neil's things, Who I Am in Christ, going through the victory over darkness with a 7-year-old African girl, 8-year-old girl. And when this girl, when the family came, they felt they had to let this girl go back into the village where the sorcerer wanted to deal with her directly, this cousin of hers. And when she left the house of her aunt and uncle where she was living, she turned to them and she said this, "You don't have to be afraid for me anymore, because I know I'm in Christ, and I'm not afraid of spirits." Isn't that wonderful?